What you're watching right now is a simulation of a molten salt nuclear reactor. In this video, you'll learn why these reactors don't risk meltdowns, why they are much cheaper to build, run and scale. Also, I'll show you some unique useful properties they have. I want to show you why the future of green energy should be taken with a grain of salt. And a containment structure. I will show you this with the help of these simulations that reflect actual physics. I will also include clips from an interview with a professor in nuclear physics, Professor Hans Fynbo. Let's get up to speed and understand the simulation. This video is part of a series called Vision of Fission, so watch that from the start if you want to make sure you understand everything. A neutron is visualized as a small black circle. A fast neutron has a white dot in the middle. Water is depicted as a blue box. It can slow down the neutron, but also absorb the neutron with some probability. Water can also heat up and completely evaporate. When they are evaporated, they can no longer absorb or slow neutrons. Graphite moderators, depicted as a white rectangle with a black border, can absorb some kinetic energy and slow down the neutron. Control rods absorbs neutrons, depicted as a black rectangle. They can move up and down to control the reactivity of the reactor. A fissile uranium nuclei is visualized as a blue circle. Waste material and non-fissile nuclei is colored as a light gray circle. They don't interact with the neutron, but they will send out delayed neutrons from time to time. Neutrons must be slowed down in order to interact with the fissile nuclei, otherwise the fission cross-section is much too low. When a slow neutron interacts with the fissile nuclei, it will undergo fission, releasing three fast prompt neutrons and a lot of energy. With some probability, the waste material will turn into xenon sometime after fission. Depicted as black, xenon is a poison for the reactor that strongly absorbs neutrons. Let's start by resetting the water's temperature. What I haven't shown you before in my simulation, but only told you, is the important step to move hot water out of the core and into the power generating steam turbine. So the idea is we have some kind of heat exchanger over here that will power a turbine with the hot water. So now with the water running around, this is a slightly better image. So now we're looking at a nuclear reactor and specifically the type graphite moderated water-cooled nuclear reactor. Please note though, most nuclear reactors, the conventional ones, are of the type light water reactors and they do not use these graphite moderators, only the water. Alright, so now we're up to speed again. Of course, this is still just a normal nuclear reactor and not a molten salt one, so let's start changing this into one. The first step we need to do is to replace the coolant in simulation with the salt, and this is typically chloride or fluoride based salts. I'll depict the salt with gray instead of this blue watercolor. Why do we want to do this? Salt can absorb much more heat without evaporating. This means we can build our nuclear reactor much cheaper without expensive high-pressure systems normally used in common conventional light water reactors.
It's also more effective than water and also more energy dense.
And salt does not absorb neutrons. And salt does not slow down neutrons, that is, salt does not moderate the neutrons. And of course, still the salt's job is to move heat into the power generating turbine, so this is still the same. Professor Hans Fynbo explained the first benefit in a bit more detail, so let's hear it from him.
Reactors that we have today, most of, we have around 450 reactors in the world today. I think about 80% of them are light water reactors. So that means that the heat that is generated by the fission is absorbed by the water, and that water is used to make steam and electricity. But that requires that all this is happening in a tank under high pressure, because otherwise the water will become steam at much lower temperature. So you raise the pressure quite high. This is a technological challenge to make these pressure tanks. Also safety issues. You've talked about Three Mile Island, what happens when these issues are not controlled. Or some happen with valve and so on.
Technical
properties there. When you have a liquid, then they can be much warmer without becoming a gas. So that means that you avoid having this need for a high pressure tank in which the whole thing is happening. That's one advantage.
Let's put molten salt instead of water in the simulation from before. Currently, it might seem like not a lot has changed, since not all of the benefits are captured by the simple simulation, but you'll soon see some more advantages. Not all molten salt reactors use graphite, some of the type fast fission molten salt reactors. But this topic is for our next video, so today I'll only show you molten salt reactors that operate with graphite and, as a result, slow neutrons. Alright, so that's a molten salt reactor for you. We're not done here yet, because some molten salt reactors has another very cool trick up its sleeve. We can dissolve the nuclear fuel into the salt and let it circulate around the coolant salt. No longer are small fuel pellets stuck in place, instead they will move around with the coolant. This is called a liquid fuel, and molten salt reactors are currently the only reactors which can use liquid fuel instead of solid fuel as the conventional one used, where the fuel is stuck in place. So what are the benefits of this design? While the fissile fuel reaches a steady state, I want to say massive thanks to my patrons and Ko-Fi supporters. You make this possible. Consider supporting these videos so I can continue making them in the future. Also consider signing up as a free tier on Patreon and Ko-Fi so I can reach you if needed. This video was sponsored by Opera Browser. Opera Browser has all of the modern features you need, like the floating music player. I can play or skip songs without interrupting my workflow. The nicely integrated split screen makes it easy to multitask or compare data from multiple sources. When you have multiple tabs open, it can be easy to get lost. But with Opera's tab traces, the shade of the tab will indicate which one you recently visited. That's some of the smart features of Opera. If you want to give it a go, download now. The link is in the description. Back to the video, let's find out why molten salt reactors and the liquid fuel is so beneficial. The first clear benefit is the enhanced safety of the molten salt reactors. If we compare molten salt reactors with light water reactors or graphite moderated light water reactors, these reactors are being held cool with active cooling constantly pumping water through the reactor core to remove heat, to keep the core much cooler than it naturally wants to be. Let's remove the water's ability to lose heat in the simulation, which mirrors the event loss of coolant accident. The water no longer removes heat effectively, and the temperature would rise to the temperature the coolant water kept the core from. This leads to dangerous instabilities even with all of the control rods in, the decay heat, and the problems I explained in this video for the Three Mile Island and the Fukushima accident. This is just a very, very dangerous state for a water-cooled reactor to be in. And in the worst cases, it will lead to meltdowns. For the molten nuclear reactor, the story is different. You run the simulation again and also turn off the ability for the molten salt to cool off. This reactor relies on a passive safety system, which, if we compare that to a car, is the idea if something goes wrong, the car should automatically brake instead of accelerate. In the event of a loss of coolant accident, the temperature will rise, yes, but the reactor can store much more heat energy, and the high boiling point of the salt ensures that no steam will form. The salt has a large negative temperature coefficient due to Doppler broadening, meaning it will become much harder to fission the hotter the salt is, because the fuel's ability to absorb neutrons decreases with temperature. Professor Hans Fynbo explained this in a bit more detail.
There's also the advantage that the nuclear material cannot melt because it's already melted. So if you talk about some of the other accidents that you've covered, then if somehow, for example, in Chernobyl, the moderation was graphite, so the reaction kept going, even if the water was evaporated away because it became warm, and then there was a meltdown of the material. This cannot happen here because the material is already in a liquid form. And then there's also some feedback things that makes it self-regulating. If the reaction rate becomes higher, then the salt becomes warmer, and then the material is moving around faster, and then the reaction rate naturally reduces. So there's kind of a negative feedback mechanism when you have this kind of a salt liquid form of the fissile material that makes it intrinsically more safe. There's also other things. You can close it down when if you want to stop it. You can sort of let this liquid go into a specially designed tank. So you can make sure that if it becomes too warm, a certain plug can melt and then the material can go into a tank where the heat can be dissipated in a more controlled manner.
As you heard from the professor, a final passive safety system for these reactors is the fuel plug. It will melt at some certain temperature and release the fuel and the coolant into some tanks to let them cool off naturally. Imagine if your microwave just ejected its lasagna the moment it started to overheat. Pretty useful. In a conventional light water reactor, whenever you want to access anything in the loop, you must shut it down for weeks. With molten salt reactors, you can just open up while it's running and apply whatever operation you wish. I've used the car analogy again. This is like popping the hood while driving to change the oil. Except here, it actually works. One example could be to look on the strong xenon poison of the reactor. The issue with the xenon, as we talked about in the Chernobyl video, due to the extremely high neutron cross-section, it makes the reactor unstable and difficult to control. For molten salt reactors, we can just remove it out of the system anytime we see it in the loop. And here is another thing we can do. In my simulation, I just magically popped in enriched fissile uranium-235 whenever I needed it, which is of course not the case for actual reactors. For conventional light water reactors, this operation is extremely expensive, but with molten salt reactors, not so much. We can put in new fuel whenever we need it and remove old fission waste products to keep the enrichment percent constant and at a safe level all while the reactor is running. Here comes yet another thing. If you watched my video about thorium nuclear fuel, where you want to breed and use the thorium fuel cycle, well, in a conventional nuclear reactor, there's a huge problem. Before thorium turns into fissile uranium, there is a middle step with a long half-life of 28 days where the element is protactinium, a sort of radioactive puberty. If this protactinium absorbs a neutron, then it won't become fissile uranium and we can't accomplish our goal of breeding cheap and safer nuclear fuel. These conventional light water reactors lets the protactinium sit in a high neutron environment. At some point, we'll reach a steady state and will destroy just as much fissile-bred fuel as we create. With the molten salt reactor, you can use a chemical separation technique that looks for protactinium and then separates it out of the nuclear core whenever we see it. We can then store the protactinium elsewhere without neutron radiation and let it transmute into the uranium fuel, and then put it back when we need it, a smart way of shielding the protactinium. Right now, these chemical separation techniques aren't perfect and in still need of development. But if we got there, then there is a problem of nuclear weapons production, as the professor explains.
Some of these fission products that come out when you fission the heavy elements, some of them have high neutron absorption, so they eat many of the neutrons, and you cannot take them out of the solid fuel rods that you have in traditional reactors because they're sitting in there. If you have a molten salt reactor, you could think of how can I, as the reactor is running, dynamically remove all these unwanted elements. So there's a chemistry problem there. How can I do that in a controlled? So there's some development needed as well. But then when we come to these molten salt reactors, then you could argue, are they then more or less prone for proliferation issues? Then you could say, okay, if you could do this online chemical processing all the time, then you can also extract this fissile material all the time. So therefore, you would have to have some scheme of looking into how this is dealt with. I don't think you can argue that molten salt reactors are much better in terms of avoiding the weapons use.
So, molten salt reactors, amazing potential, safer, smarter. The question isn't, can we build them? We already have. The question is, why aren't we?
Should probably also mention there are some challenges as well, why they are not everywhere today, because you have to have materials that can handle these hot salts, and you also need to have a whole supply chain of fuel in this form that doesn't exist today in the same way that it does for solid state fuels. I mean, there we have factories and supply chains and all these things are in place. What to do with the fuel afterwards? We have technologies for how to put them into casks and so on.
I also want to mention the molten salt reactors have never been used in an industrial scale, so not enough resources has been allocated to the technology, and so it isn't cost effective yet.